Welcome to Conversations from St. Norbert College, a program that encourages discussion in our community on today's local and global issues. Now your host for Conversations from St. Norbert College, author, professor, and nationally known sports economist, Dr. Kevin Quinn.
Welcome to Conversations from St. Norbert College. Our special guest is masculinities expert, Harry Broad, who is visiting St. Norbert College. Harry, welcome to the program.
Thank you. I'm very pleased to be here.
So let's start off with the question, what is masculinity studies?
We look at men and masculinities in ways that are inspired by women's studies and the women's movement. And what we've learned is that to understand any category, we all inhabit various identity categories by gender or race or class or religion or sexual orientation or whatever, you need to look at all of it. So if I say, okay, now I'm going to talk about gender, and what you hear is, oh, I'm going to talk about women, that's not the voice of feminism. That's the voice of patriarchy. Because gender, well, that's something women have. Men are not, you know, what's to talk about? And the same thing if someone says, we're going to talk about race, and what's heard is, oh, I'm going to talk about people of color. As if those with white racial identity, as if we are also not operating on the basis of our racial identity. So masculinity studies is using the category of gender to do what sociologists sometimes call studying up, looking at the dominant group in those categories.
So those of us of a certain age may remember the 1970s, where gender roles became topsy-turvy, at least to a lot of folks. Our parents' generation were the World War II generation, and it was easy insofar as, okay, this is what men were supposed to do, this is what women were supposed to do. Yeah. I mean, easy in quotes. And then all of a sudden comes Maude and Alan Alda.
Interesting choice, but I'm following you so far.
So, can I talk about that? I mean, was that really as revolutionary as those who went through it understood, or was that pivot away from, you know, John Wayne?
Yeah.
Was that more American unique, and what were the causes of that?
Yeah, I'm going to sound like I'm weaseling out of the question by saying both yes and no, but there actually is a solid both yes and no answer to that. Yes, it was an important change, and these things do shift, and they don't shift as much as we sometimes think they do. Every generation has this feeling of nostalgia for the old days of when men were men and when women were women, and everybody knew what that meant. The thing is, the generation we're thinking of, that they knew what it all meant, they felt the same thing, that the previous generation, That was when everybody knew what they were supposed to do, and now we're in the confusing transitional time. Things are always changing. These things are always in flux. And I'm sometimes surprised my students seem to have a very odd sense of historical change. If I show them some documentary from 5 years ago, they'll tell me, oh, it's all different now, everything's changed, that's not how it is. And then we talk about, well, what do you think of prospects for change for the future? And I say, oh, that takes a long time. That doesn't happen so fast. Yeah. So there's almost an ongoing sense of we're in gender crisis, particularly masculinity crisis.
You know, it's interesting that should be the case. I taught a course in the economics of gender for a bunch of years here on campus. And one of the things that I took away from this is that the shock about what the children were doing was palpable in the 1890s. And then again, among those folks' kids in the 1920s.
That's just what I'm talking about, yeah.
And then again, you know, I think the mythology is that women entered the workplace in the 1960s, you know, because of the liberating elements of the pill, et cetera. That's not what the data show. What the data show are the women that came of age in the 20s that often had to work during World War II. When they became empty nesters, they were returning to work in the 50s and 60s. What was different is women with children entering the workforce then. That was really a change in the 1960s.
For years, it was fairly easy to track through the census the number of working mothers in the workforce and what age were the children. But if you wanted to track working fathers, and you know who which men had family commitments and young children, you couldn't find the data. No matter how you tried to juggle numbers, the information just wasn't there. The questions weren't being asked.
And of course, you know, the movie The Best Years of Our Lives, which was about the return of the soldiers in World War II, which we've mythologized, I think, in a lot of ways over the years. I mean, they really struggled with the roles that they had to play. And you know, after 10 years of depression and then that occupied everything, and then 5 years of war that occupied everything else, to start households and you know what they were expected to do in the 1950s. The older I get, the more I realize that there was a lot of pressure on those guys.
Enormous. And you know, you use the term depression. It's not a coincidence that that's both an economic and a psychological concept. Mm-hmm. The psychological consequences of losing the breadwinner role that men are supposed to have. Is devastating, and there you can, if you graph unemployment, and then you graph male suicides, they're practically the same graph. Mm.
And what's happening now seems to be the kinds of jobs that men traditionally held. So we think about on the factory floor, you know, in an economy where a lot of jobs required a certain. Well, a perception of a certain level of physical strength, et cetera. Those are the jobs that are disappearing.
Yeah.
And you're seeing, I think, men becoming increasingly disenfranchised from the direction the American economy is getting in. So these problems you're talking about are only going to get worse, I think, in the short
term. Yeah, it's very much present in the gender breakdown of who's voting for who in the present election. Mm-hmm. It's very much... tied into the shift from a manufacturing to a service economy. Mm-hmm. That's a global phenomenon. The U.S. economy is very much hit by that. So these things are very much intertwined.
So you mentioned that masculinism, and if that's even a word, I'm not quite sure that it is, in the same way that feminism is, that there's some parallels in how the field of study is. So how are they similar? And in what ways are they different?
Yeah, I would talk about feminism. Some people talk about the male side as pro-feminism, wanting to respect some women, you know, women's autonomy. I'm perfectly happy calling myself a feminist and what I do, feminist work. I actually think it's important that men claim that title. But these are complementary fields. You really can't study one gender without the other, because our sense of who we are, the way we engender each other, these are reciprocal, intertwining activities. That being said, you can't study anybody in isolation. At the same time, you can't say everything at once. So it makes absolute sense to say, okay, here now in this course, we're going to focus on men and masculinities. And my course and a lot of other people use the pluralized masculinities, because what we learn fairly early on, if you talk about the male sexual or masculinity in the singular, you have to paint with a very broad brush to paint that picture that's going to encompass everybody. And what happens is you end up painting such a stereotyped, caricatured picture that everybody goes, oh, that's not me and mine. That's some caricature out there. So we need to study gender as it varies by race and class and sexual orientation and able-bodiedness and religion and region and age and physical appearance and ability and all these different categories which divide us in hierarchical ways. So some people use the term men's studies or masculinity studies or critical studies of men and masculinities. In various ways, we try to bring our knowledge into the academy and try to organize it in some coherent way so that we can pursue research and teaching.
And you would guess, want to distinguish this kind of work from the men's rights movement, is that right?
Yeah, I understand the men's rights movement to function as backlash against feminism. Now, it helps many individual men. If someone tells me that you've been helped by a retreat or a format or a theory that I disagree with, it would be the height of arrogance for me to say, oh no, you shouldn't have been helped by that, that's wrong. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. So I understand people find a lot of it in men's rights activities. You used to hear more about a mythopoetic men's movement people associate with rituals, many inappropriately appropriated from Native American traditions or drumming in the woods. And many men have found that healing, reconnecting with those sorts of energies. More power to you, I have no problems. But when that gets organized into a political outlook, it does take unfortunate anti-feminist aspects. It takes a form of pushing men aside. Only men can help other men, totally ignoring the generations of mothers. Mm-hmm. Who have done wonderful jobs with boys and men. So personally, whatever helps, right? Politically, I think you have to be more careful about what kind of vibes you put out there.
How does this sense of masculinity and what it means to be a man, how does that differ across different cultures? Is it vastly different, or are there some things that are just baked into the cake because of biology?
Yeah. I don't go to biological explanations for lots of reasons. The simplest one that comes to my mind first is that there's so much variety from culture to culture, and the more you study this, the more variety you see. There's so much variety that human biology just doesn't vary all that much. Mm-hmm. If you're looking for biological explanations, I don't see how you can explain the tremendous variety around the globe and in different historical periods.
Well, and that brings us into another area in which you have written extensively and have expertise, which is about the Jewish experience.
Yeah.
And Jewish culture and the Jewish-Christian dialogue in mm-hmm. particular. But transitioning into that, is there a uniquely Christian version of these gender roles, and how does that compare to, say, a Jewish version, or even Muslim or Buddhist? Yeah. What creates those differences?
There certainly are very different models of masculinities in different religious traditions. Even the same texts, people draw very different lessons from different texts. I'm a Jew. Traditionally, Jewish culture for men emphasizes brain rather than brawn. So it's book learning, intellectual study, mm-hmm. is fulfilling male roles in Judaism, more so than in some other cultures where it's brawn and athletic achievement will be more valued.
And Goliath.
There are certainly those. Yeah. So there are certainly those kinds of differences.
I was interested. It's interesting because Christianity adopts almost whole hog the Torah.
Much of it. Yeah.
I mean, it's literally part of the Christian canon, yeah. And there's a very different feel about who God is and how He works through history than in the New Testament. I mean, it's actually, if you really think about it, it's pretty remarkable that both of those books are put together.
Yeah.
Christianity.
Yeah.
So when you think about who a man is, I mentioned David, who beat him with the slingshot, right?
Yeah.
This big guy with a slingshot. What are some other male characters there that are emblematic of the way Jewish people think about masculinity?
Well, tradition, along with the male studying role. You then serve certainly in Europe, in the old country, you had women doing much more of that, the household finances and managing the household. The shy, demure woman taking orders from the man is not a Jewish model. So you certainly, at the one hand, all these patriarchal religions are patriarchal. On the other hand, it takes different forms, and you can point to different aspects of things. I wrote a book called Superman is Jewish,
I was going to ask you about that next.
Subtitle is How Comic Book Superheroes Came to Serve Truth, Justice, and the Jewish American Way. And for those who don't know, the whole comic book superhero genre is largely a creation of Jewish guys. Not entirely, but largely. And at some point I started to think, well, there are these stereotypes of Jewish men as being physically weak and cowardly and not you know, sexually aggressive and all that. Basically Clark Kent. And I thought, well, isn't this interesting? These men who are dealing with stereotypes of not being really manly, they're the ones who create these supermen. So this guy, I don't believe in coincidence, so there's got to be something there. So that's what the book investigates.
Well, I found the whole thing fascinating, and the more I dove into it, the more I found there was more there, especially because when we think about Superman, at least, you know, if you live in, you know, West Overshoe Midwest, right, you're not thinking that Superman is Jewish necessarily. What you're thinking of Superman is a more of a messianic character.
Yeah.
Where he comes in and saves the day with his great, you know, just raw strength. I mean, he's a smart guy, but he, at least the way he was portrayed in the TV show where I think most people got, you know, George Reeves, he was not a super genius.
Yeah.
He was just a little wiser, but he could do all these other things. But I was really amazed to find out that so much of the American comic book culture was created by Jewish people, right down to Mad Magazine. I mean, that was more overtly Jewish.
Yeah, there were all these slang words. I sometimes wonder.
Schlemiel, right?
Yeah, I sometimes wonder who they thought the audience was, because there's all this Yiddish slang.
Yeah.
In Mad, yeah.
And you know, as a kid growing up, I mean, Mad Magazine was go-to reading because it was, before Saturday Night Live, that was the most irreverent thing you could find, you know, without having to go to an adult bookstore, I think. And that was absolutely the product of people who were deeply rooted in Jewish culture.
Yeah. There's a mocking of authority that's very much part of Jewish tradition.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think, I don't know if a lot of people know this, but Stan Lee, who is the guy that's currently on top of the universe with the Marvel Comics, is Jewish.
Stanley Lieber, yes.
And so was his mentor, Joe Simon, was also Jewish. And so most people watching this will have some passing understanding of the Marvel Comics. I don't know if you're an expert in that. So talk about what you see when you watch, whether it's Spider-Man or you name it, where do you see the Jewish cultural thread?
Well, you know, Spider-Man in the comics is specifically situated in the neighborhood I grew up in, Forest Hills, Queens, New York. My son used to tell people my dad comes from Spider-Man's neighborhood. and most of that was a Jewish neighborhood. With some irony, because the more posh part of Forest Hills was a restricted area where Jews were not allowed. So it's a neighborhood that has an interesting history. But Peter Parker, Spider-Man's secret identity, is very much of a Clark Kent type character. You have the same dichotomy.
A student, there. He was a graduate student or something.
Originally, when Spider-Man started, he was still in high school. and very much the science geek, we would say now, being picked on by the athletic guys. You could take a character like Captain America, who was designed to very intentionally by Joe Simon and Jack Kirby to bring America into World War II. And we forget that there was a very strong isolationist sentiment in the US before Pearl Harbor. Mm-hmm. That this is a European business, let them fight it out, no reason for us to get involved. And Captain America, for the first issue of Captain America appeared a few months before Pearl Harbor. And it shows Captain America sucking Hitler in the jaw, and Hitler falls back. There's an image of that cover in the recent Captain America film, in the first one in the recent wave. And that was specifically to mobilize America to war. And the publishing company resisted it at the time. They were afraid of losing sales because there was this very strong isolationist sentiment.
By the time I was actually reading these things, and as a kid I just consumed these things, my dad was actually very supportive of that. Insofar that he felt that the attacks on the comics that were in the 1930s, that it'll rot your mind or pick your favorite terrible thing that or video games or whatever else are going to do.
Every generation, it was rock music, it was comic books, right. It was video, yeah.
Right, now it's YouTube or whatever it is. But they were past that, and they were actually talking about the anti-communist threat, which was a unifying theme, I think, across most American demographics at the time. So by that, was that Jewish DNA, shall we say, was that gone because this thing had already taken on a life of its own, or was there a piece of that in there too?
Yeah, there was a strong anti-communist crusade in the 50s. There's a particular psychologist, psychoanalyst, Frederick Wortham, who wrote a book called Seduction of the Innocent, in which he causally linked comic books to juvenile delinquency was a great concern. So there are all these violent images in the comics. He was convinced that Batman and Robin were living out a homosexual fantasy.
Like Bert and Ernie, sort
and
of,
that's,
right? Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, these costumes where you saw Robin's legs, and they're in that nice mansion with nicely furnished and all. No women in the household. So he thought this was really corrupting. And there was a strong movement to ban comics, and there was an underbelly of that raising anti-Semitic overtones.
And as I was looking into this more, I began to connect the dots with the Jewish influence on science fiction in the 30s and 40s.
Yeah.
Isaac Asimov, growing up, was one of my great heroes.
I love Asimov, so I found a way to talk about him in my book is the fairest way to say. The book could have gotten along perfectly fine without that, but I found a way to get something in there, yeah.
But, I mean, to me, an absolutely fascinating character. First of all, a polymath. And as I got older, I realized while I idolized him as a kid, I probably wouldn't want to be in the same room with him for more than about 10 minutes because he probably would have annoyed the hell out of me. But he, I mean, he was the son of two folks who came from Russia, I think, Jewish immigrants from Russia, settled in New York, which was not an unusual thing to do. Mm-hmm. They opened up a candy shop where he worked, and he was imbued with the values of education, study, which very much are Jewish values, hard work.
Yeah.
And he was part of that wave of kids that got educated in New York City. I mean, it's almost impossible to imagine the kind of effort that would be taken to educate immigrant kids the way that New York did it back in the 30s. And he winds up getting a PhD in biochemistry. And then writing on, science fiction, which, you know, had, you know, Mort Weisinger, Harry Kuttner, Stanley Weinbaum. These were all giants of the time. As a kid, I had no clue whatsoever about what New York life was about or that these guys were Jewish. It seemed so profoundly Pax Americana in what I was reading.
Well, you know, on the one hand, yes, and let's not go overboard. These are all not exclusively Jewish characteristics. Mm-hmm. We're sitting here in lovely St. Norbert College, which also believes in education and hard work and all these things, but it gets channeled in different directions and different traditions. That's true. And people also often group together fantasy and science fiction. And in Judaism, there's this messianic impulse, and science fiction fits better for a lot of Jews. Not consciously, nobody's thinking, I'm a Jew, therefore let me write science fiction, but the rationalist bent, the scientific rather than supernatural basis, that it's oriented towards the future. Fantasy worlds tend to take place in a different where. Middle Earth, Narnia. Science fiction tends to take place in a projected future. And I think there is something about fundamental Jewish mindset that if we start to exercise our imaginations, there's a natural tendency to go more towards a scientific future than a supernatural alternative present.
My recollection is that the whole science fiction realm was very male dominated.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Not entirely, but I mean, and you do have some women who took on male names to get published.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Well, and that wouldn't surprise me, partly because science was so considered to be the domain of males, and,
exactly.
And Madame Curie and her daughter notwithstanding, I mean, that was mm-hmm. not supposed to be for mm-hmm. for females. What changed that in your mind? What created the opportunity for women to get more into, whether it's science fiction or science, the fields that were considered to be male-dominated? And, I mean, to what extent did males play a role in helping that or hindering that, do you think?
Both. It's largely a function of the women's movement, which inspires a whole bunch of change. Which is it's self-inspired by economic changes and structural changes in the U.S. economy and the structure of science. When you not to over-engage in the stereotype, but there is this way of thinking of hard science versus soft science, and when you're building up armaments and manufacturing. That appears to be more of a hard technology versus biological sciences, information processing. There are reasons that brain science is now cutting edge of medicine at the same time that computer technology is the cutting edge of technology. So biological sciences, information processing are softer ends of science. Than hard manufacturing, building up armaments, and it fits into how we have stereotyped, but I don't think this is natural, biological, this is social, but that's part of the picture. I mean, even when girls and boys behave the same way, we don't see it because we're trained not to see it. We know that boys don't play with dolls. How do we know that? Because when boys do play with dolls, we call them action figures.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, those are dolls.
Well, you know, actually, we had somebody on this program who was all about the dolls for boys.
The Wonder Crew. Yeah,
and they're taking off like crazy.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
exactly.
That just proves your point exactly.
Exactly
that
so.
If you open it up. So in addition to writing about Superman and masculinity and, you know, the Jewish experience, you also write about racism, which actually, to me, makes some sense because whether, you know, you're talking about how different groups interact with each other, male, female, you know, by religion or by, you know, color or social class, they all kind of are the same thing.
Yeah.
So you've written specifically about white privilege.
Yeah.
So how do you define that term? I mean, that's a bit of a politically charged term now, or it's become
yeah.
so. So how do you define it?
Privilege is simply an unearned benefit that comes to me by virtue of my membership in a social group that's dominant in the society. So I did move from studying masculinities to studying whitenesses.
Mm-hmm.
So many campuses invite me to do a talk that I call, use different titles, Working From and Against Privilege, or What's a Straight White Male Doing in the Feminist, Anti-Racist, and LGBTQ Movements. So a lot of what I do is take whatever dominant group identity characteristics, identity groups I happen to carry, and see how can I develop myself as a social justice ally.
Well, that is absolutely fascinating. You've had an incredibly fascinating academic journey, and we're very lucky to have you on our campus this semester, and also, you know, on our show. Unfortunately, we're out of time. It goes by so quickly.
Yes.
I hope you've enjoyed the show as much as I have. Until next time, I'm wishing you best conversations from St. Norbert College.